Hi, a very good morning. I'm Vishnu Subramaniam from Java's Lab Study. In this video, we're going to learn about Fastai Learner. We're going to learn it in different parts. The first part is inspired by the Fastai Learner code from the 19th chapter of Deep Learning for Coders with Fastai and PyTorch book. If we go to the 19th chapter and learner, we'll be looking at this particular learner class, which is like a small simplified version of the actual learner class. The actual learner class looks something like this. So what we will do is we will understand how this learner class works. And in the next part, we'll try to understand how or explore some of the functionalities, key functionalities in the Fastai Learner's code. And in the coming videos, we will try to understand how some of the specialized learners like CNN Learner, which is renamed as Vision Learner in the latest version, and Unit Learner and other learners work. We'll see what happens beneath these learners. To understand this learner, let's open the learner from Fastai book, Git repository, okay, and let's look at what happens line by line. So here we can see the init function, which is called first. We see a bunch of arguments to the function model DLS, and the first magic happens here. Instead of calling in a typical way like self.model equal to model, self.dls equal to DLS loss function, the way all these attributes are saved is using store attribute, just calling store attribute. The store attribute comes actually from Fastcode. We can just check it from here. So all it does is it stores all the parameters that is being passed to the learner constructor init function basically to the self attribute. So whatever we pass here gets stored in self.model, self.dls, self.loss function. Yep. And CBS stands for callbacks. By default, Fastai relies heavy on callbacks. And let's see what are some of the default callbacks that are being used. We can see that the default callbacks is a list, and it contains train, eval callback, recorder, progress callback. So all we are doing here in this line is we are iterating through each callback. And for each callback, we're setting up an attribute called learner. And to this learner, we set up an object of learner. So basically what happens is inside each of these callbacks, it can access any attributes like model, data loader, or loss function from inside these callbacks. That's a very interesting way of using it. And then we have a couple of functionalities like one batch, one epoch, fit, and call. We'll start with fit, and when we try to understand what is happening inside fit, we'll try to understand the other functionalities. The fit is where we say learner.fit and we pass in some number like 10, and basically we're asking Fastai to train a model for 10 epochs. So a simplified version of fit looks like this. Let's come to this line a bit later. This is very, if we have used PyTorch, it's very simple. All we are doing is we are passing all the parameters to the optimizer along with the learning rate. We're initializing epoch, and then we are iterating through the number of epochs. Let's say if we have 10 epochs, 1, 2, 3, goes on. And we run for one epoch for training is true, and one epoch for validation. We're using the same epoch here. And if there is an exception, I think it raises cancel fit exception. And then again, it says self after fit. Basically, this part is almost similar to what we do in PyTorch, except that it is covered with these two lines, self of before fit and self of after fit. So what happens exactly? So when we call something like this self of, it basically means we are calling the constructor of learner class or any class in particular. So what happens is Python will call the call function that we have implemented here. And what we do here is we iterate through each callback and we check if that callback has an attribute or a function called before fit or after fit or any other callback. If it's not there, if it has not implemented, then we call a functionality called noob. All noob does is it basically says do nothing. Whatever we pass as input, it returns the same thing. So this is one of the reasons why our callbacks need not have everything, right? Let's look at the source code of this and see what it contains. We'll not be getting into the details of that, but let's look at. So it has a before fit function, but it doesn't have an after fit function. So here what happens is it looks for before fit, it's there. So it just calls before fit, it executes the before fit functionality of train eval callback. Since it doesn't have after fit, basically the noob gets called. So this now looks very clear. The main key thing that's very different from vanilla PyTorch is self of before fit and self of after fit. So now let's go and see what happens in one epoch. So in one epoch, we set the training attribute of model to either true or false. That's what we say, true or false. This is very important because while training, you want certain parameters of your model like batch normalization dropout to behave differently than how they behave in validation. And then you have a callback here, what you want to do before the epoch starts and what you want to do after the epoch starts. You have any callback implementing these functions. You can change how the entire learner functions. And then for training, you want to extract the train data loader, and for validation, you want to extract the validation data loader. That's what is happening here. Our data loader generally contains both train data loader and validation data loader. And then we just iterate through the data loader. We have a progress bar, and then we call one batch. So now we have finished one epoch also, which is very similar, except that we are calling self of before epoch and self of after epoch. We have these two callbacks, and then we have a data loader which encompasses both the train and validation data loader. Then let's look at one batch. In one batch, what happens in general is we take input XP and YB output. We pass it to a model. We get predictions. We pass the predictions to a loss function along with the target. We get the loss. And if the training is true, which is happening here, then we do backpropagation, and when we do optimization, basically we calculate the gradients here and we adjust the gradients with the weights. We basically adjust, learn the new weights. We do this, and then we have again the callback. This is all we do. And the most interesting thing here is, again, the way callbacks are implemented. I think in this video, you would have got a clear understanding, or you would have got a glimpse of how Fastai Learner works. So what we'll do is, in the next video, part two of this, we will look at this, how callbacks works. It basically inherits get attribute. It's subclass of get attribute, and that's how it works. I hope you like this video. If you like this video, hit the like button. And if you have any comments or suggestions, please leave it in the comment section. I'll be working on the next video. See you shortly. Thank you. Bye-bye.